This is Lemmy Kitty powered by Jacques Brel. Do you know Jacques Brel, Paul?
We all know Jacques Brel, that well-known Belgian Frenchman.
The Belgian Frenchman.
Absolutely, yeah.
Was he born in Belgium and moved to France, or the other way around?
He's one of those Belgians that gets appropriated by the French. Eric Zemmour in the presidential election said, you know, if you want to be a good French person, you've got to be listening to... He went through a whole list of artists. One of them was Jacques Brel. And everybody pointed out that actually Jacques Brel, like Johnny Hallyday, was actually Belgian. So,
yeah. Is it a bit of the British taking credit for Scottish inventions? Is it similar?
It's a bit like, you know, claiming Terry Wogan, Ronan Keating, you know, it's all that kind of cultural appropriation. That's the name of the game.
That is the name of the game. So, yes, we're joined by Dr. Paul Smith, Associate Professor of French History and Francophone Studies at the University of Nottingham. He's a regular contributor to France 24 and author of History of the French Senate, and most recently author of the French politics blog, Fifth and a Half Republic. So, judging from the debate, who do you think came out on top?
Macron.
And why?
Well, he was more convincing in terms of the detail. I mean, the point is that you have about that debate. It's quite interesting to look at the post-debate opinion poll results. 59% of French people said they found him more credible, 39% Le Pen. So clearly he came out on top, but the big difference is that he's in control of the detail. He has, he knows the stuff, and that was very clear early on. The first topic they discussed was this issue of the cost of living, and his figures, you know, he had the figures at his fingertips. He understands how it works, and he completely demolished her, and she was all at sea.
He did commend Le Pen on her command of statistics, though.
Sorry?
He did commend Le Pen on her command of the statistics.
Well, but he did it ironically, yeah.
But this was an element, because obviously not all voters, they're not all piercing academics such as yourself, and aren't interested always in the detail.
No, absolutely.
So would that arrogance have come off necessarily in a way that was beneficial to him?
Well, that's been one of the themes, hasn't it? That he was arrogant throughout the debate. You know, if you look at some of the, it's true that he was badly positioned. I mean, the whole setup of the debate in terms of physical space, when you look at the camera shots, the physical space didn't work in his favor. And everybody talks about, you know, these various stills of his face. But, you know, she can gurn for France. So in that regard, you know, I don't think either of them did particularly well. But I absolutely accept your point that in terms of the technical stuff, does the average French voter really have all that, you know, grasp of the details? And I'd say that where she scored well, and this is again one of the things where some of the post-match analysis was very interesting, were precisely those questions of pension reform and cost of living.
It's one of the big issues, isn't it?
It's one of the big issues, absolutely. And those were the two where actually she scored better than him. So I absolutely take your point that even though, you know, he dismantles her arguments, does that actually play well in the, you know, out in what the French call La France profonde, deep France?
Is
that on? Is that the plateau in the centre?
Deep France is, it's the idea of France beyond the cities, beyond the, you know, that kind of cliched idea of the year in Provence. Kind of the back of beyond, but not quite, because there are people who live there. But it's the idea of...
Is it there parallel to the Rust Belt or the Red Wall? Is it similar in a way?
Yes and no, because it's rural. The point about, you know, the Rust Belt is that it's precisely post-industrial Ohio. You know, that's the kind of the kind of idea, or Pennsylvania, whereas Red Wall is very urban. But actually, where she scored well in the first round, if we look at the breakdown, and the French do some brilliant maps, I have to say French political geography is like light years ahead of what we do. Where she's scoring well and where she was campaigning in between rounds is out in rural France. Yeah, absolutely. Not what we would expect necessarily to be the kind of the heartland of the far right. But in France, that's what's been happening. It's not the only place where she's scoring well. She's doing well in post-industrial areas as well. There is a kind of Rust Belt Red Wall thing going on in the north of France, by which I mean the area kind of, you know, just south of Calais before you get to Paris, and also out towards
Lille. Towards the northeast.
Yeah, the northeast. Yeah. The French call it the north, le nord, but actually it's really the northeast. Yeah, absolutely.
So... So on EU membership, this was a big change from last time with Le Pen, particularly. How much we, because we can't quantify being British and not being able to understand the French and French as well as you. How much has that illusion or the policy on her not being in favour of EU membership is that transparent to the French voter?
Yeah, well, no, it isn't. I mean, she's not talking about Frexit, because one of the, you know, the kind of, again, the analysis, the post-mortem analysis of 2017 was that when she started talking about Frexit, when she started talking about coming out of the Eurozone, that upset French savers, you know, because the French are a nation of savers. They don't live on credit, they live on their savings. And the idea that suddenly we're going to lose the euro, we were going to lose money, that swayed. You know, she only got 34% last time, and we thought she was going to get 40. Well, that was the kind of the top whack, and she didn't was a big failure. So she's ditched openly expressing the idea of Frexit and coming out of the euro. But when you dig down into the detail of what she's talking about, so the primacy of French law over European law, the ideas of reorganizing, you know, taking France out of the integrated command structure of NATO. I know that's not EU, but it's all linked up.
Yeah, she also criticized the common agricultural policy and then talked about having a grand reform of the EU, which we all understand the EU and its technocratic modus operandi. That's not something you can really do overnight, is it?
It's not something you can do overnight. These are promises that she probably can't keep anyway. But then, you know, that's what the far right do. But to go back a stage to what you're saying, really, to what you're asking about the EU, absolutely. I mean, it's she's really talking about Frexit by another means, reorganising things within the EU that would make it almost impossible for the EU to function. And this is important, because we're talking about France. We're not talking about Poland. We're not talking about Hungary. We're talking about a country that is absolutely central to the shape and the structure and the form of the European Union.
Right from the European steel and coal community. I thought that she contradicted herself somewhat, because she talked about France having the power to make these grand reforms, whatever they may have been, but then talked about the economic dominance of Germany and the fact that she sees it, that Germany runs the EU in their interests. So that her policy doesn't actually make sense there, does it? Because if France had any leverage, then she claims it doesn't. So I was a bit confused.
Well, I mean, that, again, that's the confusionism that comes with, you know, to some extent with all candidates, but certainly with Le Pen, the you can say one thing on the one part. I mean, the common agricultural policy has been enormously beneficial to French farmers.
Yeah, so you were talking about that. Taking into consideration Marine Le Pen to top with ties with Russia and its Eurosceptic platform, what would it mean for the future of France's relationship with the European Union if Marine Le Pen was elected?
I think it would make the relationship extremely difficult. I mean, you know, you have a serious European player becoming her kind of the sort of Trumpist part of her is that she would become utterly unpredictable. That you would have a French leader. You know, France is what, the third, fourth most important military power in the world. I mean, we can talk about statistics until we're blue in the face, but you know, it's a big player. I know that some politicians in this country like to think of France as not being terribly important, but it's a big military player right around the world. It's got the largest maritime zone in the world. And suddenly you've got a head of state who's in charge of all the buttons and whose policy is going to break, in a very Putin-esque way actually, is going to break with all of the machinery of balance and counterbalance.
At the last election rally she had in the last election, I remember her talking very, very aggressively about rebuilding the French Navy. And she wanted to name a flagship the Richelieu. So she has had quite militaristic ambitions in the past. Is that something she's moved away from now?
No, I don't think so. I think it's, again, you know, there's a lot of the stuff that we're talking about two very different campaigns here. It's very important to focus on that in 2017 she really tried to play the kind of what the French call regalian, the kind of the future head of state role. And that's been much less the case this time. She really focused, certainly in the lead up to the first round, although she has talked about the regalian role. In the first round, she focused very much more on the local, on going sotto voce, you know, with a soft voice, talking to people, presenting herself as the candidate of the people, and her slogan is about that. It's there in her programme. You can see what her plans are in terms of defence, but it's much less of the of playing up to that, you know, that kind of idea of the head of a warlike state. But it will. It's there, and she's no different in that regard. Of course, you know, she's kind of painted herself as a new de Gaulle. She isn't.
Yeah.
But, you know, the idea of France as an independent player.
Yeah, because her campaign slogan on her posters is, I believe, is Femme d'État, which means stateswoman in French.
Yeah.
So she is still trying to have that model of a what would you call it, multi-generational French leader, because obviously de Gaulle is someone we still reference and talk about now.
Yeah. Well, I mean, her problem is that she doesn't have that. She doesn't have when we look at the breakdown of the qualities of all of the candidates, you know, even before the first round, what were the qualities that certain people have? You know, Macron was way up there in terms of the idea of having what the French call the presidential right stuff, l'étoffe, okay, the stuff. Whereas, you know, she was quite a long way down on that. So that idea of femme d'état, okay, so she's trying to present herself as looking like a president, but that's not actually the kind of campaign she delivered. It was much more, you know, woman of the people out there doing the markets, being out in rural France, la France profonde, and that's what she's been doing this week. So there's quite a difference between the two campaigns.
So you talk about that and him looking more presidential. After initially standing on a platform, what many would argue is the centre-left in 2017, Macron's programmatic shift has arguably turned increasingly rightwards. Do you think he has replaced the old Republican vote? And more importantly, is he just essentially a candidate for the rich and privileged? Is he just too out of touch with working class people for them to want to vote for him?
Well, that's a big question. Okay, so... No, well, there are a lot of questions bound up in that.
Yeah, there is. Yeah, I mean, so I could have broke that down.
Well, very clearly, look, you know, if we look at the results of the first round, you've actually got three things, haven't you? You've got a nationalist, essentialist, far right. You've got a progressive centre that sees itself as pro-European. And then you've got the third place candidate, Mélenchon, who I'm sure we're going to talk about maybe a bit later. Yes, but he's this kind of... A kind of left Eurosceptic, quite radical left, but also got quite a number of ecologist votes, you know, because he's got a realistic environmental policy as well. So we're in the presence of three political forces. And within that, let's deal with the first thing, which is that you asked, has he gobbled up the mainstream, you know, the mainstream right-wing party, Les Républicains? Yes.
Yes, definitely.
You know, their candidate got 4.6% of the vote. She tried when Pécresse, Valérie Pécresse, their candidate, won the nomination, everybody was focusing on, oh yeah, she's going to steal all the votes from Macron on the right because, you know, basically she's coming from the same sort of place. But of course it happened the other way around. He cannibalized her vote. The other thing she was trying to do was to present herself as being tough on law and order and immigration, but there are two other candidates who are doing it much more in a much more outspoken way than her, and who've already occupied that ground. So there's really nobody for her to appeal to. Absolutely agree that Macron has, and you know, broadly speaking, we've talked about Macron as a candidate who, from 2017 to 2022 has gradually drifted towards the right. I think that's right. There are people who call themselves left Macronist, but they are not...
Are they sort of socially liberal?
Yeah, they're... Well, it's the old Christian Democrats. Right. Oh, it's not Christian Democrats, sorry, Social Democrats. You know, what happened to...
Well, François Hollande's...
Well, the old... Yeah, and those who've remained with Macron, people like Christian Castaner, they're still there. But I think that a lot of people on the left who voted for Macron, willingly voted for Macron in 2017, probably voted for Mélenchon this time because they feel that Macron hasn't delivered on any of the kind of promises to the left. Whereas there's this certainly a perception that he, you know, with abolishing tax on the wealth tax right at the beginning of his presidency, failing to really deal in a serious way with the Gilets Jaunes crisis. You know, that is very easy to throw the, everybody gets accused of being the président des riches. That's just, you know, kind of one of the stickers that gets pinned on your back. But
is it what in French politics? Right?
Yeah, I heard on the Times podcast, yeah, they said that the French president always gets a huge amount of stick, no matter who it is.
Yeah.
And a lot of criticism, even if it's undue.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the French president is, if you don't deliver, you know, if it looks like, if the only major reform that anybody can remember is the fact that you've abolished, you know, people forget that he's also abolished other taxes that everybody had to pay. So various local taxes have been removed, and we're not paying those anymore. Well, the French aren't paying those anymore.
Which taxes were they?
Some of the local taxes, that taxe d'habitation was actually abolished. So that's been, and that's been replaced with other ways of funding local services.
And but the, that's beneficial to working class.
It's beneficial to everybody because it's been abolished, so everybody gets it. But the point is that it's very difficult to get away from that, you know, président des riches tag. And of course, it doesn't, you know, his kind of background doesn't help him to kind of shake that off. So I think that's certainly the perception, although, you know, he made the point that in the debate on Wednesday that nowhere in Le Pen's programme does it actually mention tackling unemployment, chômage. She was much more focused on doing other things that actually their impact, abolishing VAT, for example, the impact of that would be actually would not be, you know, across the board, because although it would mean nobody paid VAT on energy, for example, that's what she was suggesting. Actually, you know, relatively speaking, if you're a wealthy person, then you can soak up to VAT. It's the people. So you're not targeting the people who need it.
Okay, this is University Radio Nottingham with George Scotland and Damian Stephen. We're with regular France 24 contributor Professor Paul Smith. Do you remember Plastic Bertrand?
Another Belgian.
Is he Belgian as well?
Yes, but I do remember him.
This is your RN.
That was Plastic Bertrand, and I've been informed by our expert guest, Professor Paul Smith, that he is in fact Belgian.
That's brilliant, yeah.
As Jack Brel is as well. He'll be coming up a bit later. I just wanted
it's all a learning process, isn't it?
Well, that's why he's here.
We
are not the experts. We don't claim to be. We're after the answers.
That's the Francophone studies bit of my brief, you know, that French is more than just France. So there you are.
How much does the French Revolution feed into French politics and daily political life?
That's a great question.
Not very much, I don't think. I mean, there are moments where the French, when they talk about the Republic and all that, but the French Revolution of 1789 wasn't about the Republic. It was about constraining the king to accept the idea of the will of the people, that the nation, while the king represents the nation on the one hand, so too do, you know, the people are the nation. And I think that there's a kind of a lazy reference back to the French Revolution and progressiveness and all that kind of stuff that gets wheeled out, but that
would you charge that the left of doing that or the French right?
No, everybody does, you know, right across the board. It's not some of the French right are, some of the people who'll vote Le Pen tomorrow are actually, you know, monarchists and hardline anti-Greek Catholics, as they would call themselves. But generally speaking, it's across the board. The values of the revolution, you know, everybody claims to sign up to liberté, égalité, fraternité. So liberty, equality and brotherhood. So there's this kind of lip service, but it's not an everyday kind of
How big is the restoration movement in France? Because that's something I've never addressed.
It's minuscule, but they are there, and they shout very loudly. So
is it like a Cornish nationalist sort of size?
I think it's probably smaller than that. I'm a great fan of Cornwall. I have no problem with the Cornish nationalists. I have a great deal of problems with
Gordon Ramsay, who has declared war on the Cornish.
Well, that's Gordon for you. It's not a big movement.
So to summarise, would you say the way in which the French hark back to the revolution in that lazy sort of way you've described, is similar to how the British would talk about Winston Churchill?
Well, I think that the historical parallels the French talk about are actually the resistance and de Gaulle. And of course, right. The big kind of political, the historical reference or argument that is being had or has been had through this campaign has been the Vichy regime and what Vichy was all about. Not so much with under Le Pen, but certainly with Eric Zemmour, her far right wing rival. But also, there is a kind of, you know, within the core, the hardcore support for Le Pen, there are what we call in French les nostalgiques de Vichy, people who think that the Vichy regime was not a bad thing. That kind of essentialist identity, French identity, that is white, that is Catholic, that is anti-cosmopolitan. You know, a lot of the language that we see for the Vichy regime, that's the regime that rules France from 1940 to 1944. Collaborationist regime. A lot of that language, you know, about cosmopolitanism that's undermined France, groups like the Freemasons and all of this kind of stuff, it's anti-Semitic. Well, you can, a lot of that stuff you can transfer over to the subtext,
yeah,
of what is being talked about, not just by Zemmour, who kind of articulated a lot of this very openly, but also by Le Pen less openly, but it's very clearly there.
So is it similar in a way in how in Italy there are people that still sympathise or use the symbolism of Mussolini?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, a lot of this stuff about her father, for example, suggesting that Le Pen's father, Jean-Marie Le Pen, saying that the gas chambers were just a detail of history, you know, and her kind of not openly saying that, but saying things that are not a million miles away from that, are kind of a nostalgia for that period.
But that's a very interesting point, because we sort of touched on it earlier, is how many people within the French far right know that the current policy and the current image that's been projected during this campaign is a bit of a smokescreen and there's a bit of a nudge and a wink and no to vote for her anyway, because a lot of this is just lip service to get elected.
Well, no, I think that we need to make a distinction between those who are her core supporters, you know, the party and the people who are supporting Le Pen, who know this very well, and then some of the electorate kind of buy into this idea, you know, let's be open about this, that whereas the Vichy regime was clearly anti-Semitic, there's a great deal of Islamophobia that underpins the far right in France, and it's not just Islamophobia, it's a dislike of the other. And that includes, by the way, you know, not just France's Muslim population, its black population, sub-Saharan African population, even other Europeans.
The English.
Look, you know, no, joking apart, Le Pen does not like, doesn't understand foreigners. She doesn't even understand, you know, she's a good Catholic.
She referred to them as aliens the other night.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, she is a, you know, an absolutely straight down the line, identifies with this idea of French and Catholic. She doesn't even understand Protestantism. You know, okay, there are only 500,000 Protestants in France, and they probably won't be voting for her. But...
are they all in Normandy?
No. They're mostly in the south of France, actually.
Oh, really?
The really strong areas of Protestantism were Nîmes and Montpellier. You know, this all goes back to the history of the counter Reformation and persecution of Protestants. Some in Alsace, so in the east of France, you got quite a large Protestant population, but mostly in the south, as I say, around places like Nîmes and Montpellier. But so to go back to your original question, is this something that her voters know? The answer is some of them do and are willing to sign up to that. For others, of course, she's appealing to those who are not particularly wedded to her ideas, but who are angry. You know, and the French do anger so terribly well.
Yes, brilliant nation.
We talked about this earlier, didn't we?
Well, yeah, because we was on about Macron's supposed arrogance in the debate, and I says, well, surely the French would quite like that. Because the French have always been charmingly passionate and arrogant, and it's part of their charm as a people.
Well, yes, I think that's true, but I think that also, I mean, when I talk about the anger I'm kind of thinking of here is the Yellow Vest movement.
Right, right.
And it's quite interesting that back in the day, when that was happening, back in 2018, 2019, we were all making the point, all of us commentators were saying how this is a movement that doesn't want to be categorised as far right or far left, but we could see, you know, when they did come up with any kind of programme, you could see there were elements of this and there were elements of that. They haven't gone away. They're still fed up. They're still angry. But actually, she didn't need to, for example, Le Pen didn't need to, the French use the word récupérer, it's the idea of gathered them up. She didn't need to sort of put herself at the head. And they always said, of course, that they were apolitical. Okay, well, that's fine. But of course, she didn't need
to. Protesting, I suppose.
They're protesting,
that's not non-political.
Well, she didn't, not quite so. She didn't need to actually kind of gather them up as supporters, because she knew that if Macron failed to deal with that, they would be there as a pool, an enormous kind of well of anger that she could tap into. And in fact, this is something that Mélenchon's supporters, the far left candidate or the left wing candidate, depending on how you want to define him, I still see him as being on the far left, but his supporters are saying, look, ahead of the general election, because that's what comes up in June once we get past tomorrow, what we need to do as a left-wing party is appeal. What we're not doing is appealing to those angry rural voters or people who are not living in the big cities but living, you know, just beyond what we call peri-urban. Those people are still angry. They are, and they use the term that they've come up with on the left is fâché. Pas facho. Now, fâché means to be cross. Facho is a nickname for a fascist. So the idea is that these people are cross, but they're not fascists. They're not voting for her because they would normally vote for her. They're voting for her as a kind of reflex. And so we...
A protest vote.
And what I'm... And, you know, if I put myself into the skin of some of the, you know, Mélenchon's people who are thinking tactics for the general election, what I need to do now, I've kind of consolidated my urban... disaffected on the left, 22% of the vote on the 10th of April. Now I need to appeal to those people who are fed up with Macron. Okay, let's get past, let's not vote for her, but let's get through to the general election and then let's go out and appeal to those people, because we don't think that they are dyed-in-the-wool Le Pen supporters, but they are angry.
So how much... So obviously Marine Le Pen has since 2018... gone a platform of de-demonisation, as it's called.
No, it predates that.
Okay, how much can the French electorate really trust Marine Le Pen's moderate and rebranded image?
Well, again, it's one of the things that we've seen. You know, you talk about the moderate image is that on the Monday after the first round, I did various programmes talking about how various opinion polls were talking about it being too close to call. Okay, that she was on 49%, he was on 51%, and as we all know, that's too close to call. That, you know, that's the kind of thing, because
the
margin of error is so tight there that you're thinking, crikey. Since then, it's drifted out.
Yeah.
And one of the, I think it's the last opinion poll. You're not allowed an opinion poll on the Saturday. Friday is when all campaigning stops. The last opinion poll I saw actually had it stretching out to 55, 56, 57, plays 43. Okay, so that's a much wider... Because, and again, the kind of analysis to this is now we're actually looking at... This is where her programme actually comes under the spotlight. That there's been so... You know, you've got a first-round campaign with 12 candidates. That's a lot of noise. And you can...
In one space.
And you can kind of deliberately... lose yourself in that if you want to. I mean, people said that Macron didn't really campaign, and that's true. I don't have a problem with that analysis. Neither did she, really, in the way that we were anticipating. Her campaign team decided that it was going to be this low-key, local. Let Zemmour take all the, you know, take the spotlight and be outrageous and say things that...
Right,
yeah, absolutely. He can be the poster boy,
yeah.
But he will run out of steam, and he did. Although he still got 7% of the vote.
Yeah, over 2 million, it was quite a large amount of votes, actually.
Yeah,
he said 7% in Britain in a constituency by-election. It's not many people, but that is actually quite a sizable amount.
Yeah, and we think that, you know, a fair number of those will transfer straight over to her. I mean, it's going to be part of the thing that we will do after the vote tomorrow is dissect it and look at the... There'll be all kinds of analysis.
I know
of
a French pollster, Mr. Vincent Toutain, is a contemporary of mine,
right,
who says the company he works for in Paris reckons that Marine Le Pen will seize about 17 to 19% of Mélenchon's vote and the majority of Eric Zemmour's, but that wouldn't be sufficient to take her over the line to beat Macron. And as you say, the polls are widening now. The final polls are widening.
Yeah.
So there really isn't much chance of a Le Pen victory, is there?
Who knows? It's a two-horse race. I've become a bit, I called it on Brexit. I called it on Trump. I called it on...
Which way?
Which way you called it?
I got it right, okay? I wouldn't be boasting about it but I've got bad feet. I've got, you know, a slightly... I mean, you know, I thought about posting on my Twitter account yesterday the figure that I think she'll actually get, and I'm not going to do that because I could be colossally wrong and she might even win. But in a two-horse race, you know, you've got to be really confident to think that it's... And as you say, you know, we don't know how the Mélenchon people are going to vote, whether they abstain. I mean, one of the other problems, and this is a bonkers, you know, who on earth programmed the second round of the presidential election for the weekend when Paris schools go on spring holiday? You know, so we're all off to our second homes.
Yeah.
This morning, everybody was focusing on the bouchons, the tailbacks on the motorways. So those people, either they're voting by proxy. I heard a statistic the other day, actually, about 1 million people have applied for proxy votes.
Wow.
That's astonishing. But it tells you something.
Does that mean by post or...?
Well, you get your mum to vote for you.
Right, okay, so because I've heard that postal voting is not a big thing in France.
No, it's traditionally not. But it's proxy voting, so the idea that you would go... I did it in the last general election. A mate of mine who'd moved to Australia was still eligible to vote here, so I voted for him in his old polling station,
right,
here in Beeston. But anyway, to go back to what you were asking, what was that?
Goodness me, let me just find that. Oh, what's that?
Well, we're talking about the widening of the polls, but how...
The widening of the polls, that's right. So it's weekend. Been the... You're absolutely right. It's the received wisdom on that is that now that everybody's actually only focusing on her policies versus his policies and beginning to realise what it's about, suddenly we're thinking, actually, that's not really what we want. So... You know, I could see her quite easily slipping down to 41%, which will still be a decent vote compared to 2017. But it will be a disaster for her personally, because she's supposed to be pushing him all the way. Right. If the final vote tomorrow is anything below 43%, she is, as we say in English, toast.
Well, because I wanted to ask that, because obviously the Conservative Party in Britain suffered many general election defeats, and it came to the point in 2010 where... Some media commentators, such as Peter Hitchens, said that if it didn't win in 2010, it would have been finished as a party, its donors would have gone. Is that a similar situation for Rassemblement National and Marine Le Pen if she doesn't win this time, or come close?
Well, no, I think that the party is there now. It's a very small party. You know, they claim to have 20,000 members, but it's... I was discussing this with a friend of mine who works in the... A colleague of mine who works in the same areas at Edinburgh University, Emile Chabal. The idea that actually in 2017 and this time round, we're looking at candidates who don't really have a big party behind them. You know, the big parties with big local federations, local memberships, with activists getting out and campaigning, supporting the campaign... That's not La République en Marche. It's not the Rassemblement National. Now, you ask the question, what would happen? Does it disappear if she disappears? Yes and no. I think that there are other people who would step in. We know that there's her niece. Well, she's put herself beyond the pale of the Rassemblement National because she's backing Zemmour. I'm talking about Marion Maréchal, as you know. Zemmour fancies himself as somebody who can create a new right-wing party out of the ashes of Les Républicains and his own movement. And if she... And this is, you know, why I'm wondering about what his voters will do. If she, you know, if her performance tomorrow is the proverbial car crash, there are plenty of people waiting to step in.
So Zemmour, you said he would pick the vote, he would try and pick up the support there from the ashes. Would he then go on a strategy of moderating his platform.
No, I think he would say that that's too much moderation, that there is something to be
and
said for
the other way.
I think that he's not capable of moderation, and he sees no future in that he would radicalize. And she, Marion Maréchal, is very much the same. She is not...
She's quite young as well, isn't she? She's 29, 20.
In her late 20s now. Yeah, I mean, she first became a deputy in the 2012 general election. And, I mean, she's a, you know, an intellectual lightweight, but, you know, intellectual lightweights sometimes get elected.
Well, yeah, Donald Trump.
Tony Blair. join us after this. We're talking to Professor Paul Smith, our expert on French politics, regular France 24 contributor. Mm-hmm. Going on Talk Radio with Trisha Garrard later.
At 1 p.m. It's brilliant. We play the music.
George Scotland and Damian Stephen. The Breakfast Show. URN.
We play this.
DJ!
This is URN.
University
Radio.
Nottingham.
Christmas.
If you just joined us, the time is 10:45. This is George Scott and Damian Stephen on the Breakfast Show. It's our French presidential special. That was Bastille Day by Rush. We're joined by Paul Smith, Associate Professor of French History and Francophone Studies at the University of Nottingham. Brilliant to have with us. Regular contributor of France 24 and author of History of the French Senate and most recently author of French Politics blog, Fifth and a Half Republic. Hello again, Paul.
Hello.
And did you enjoy that Bastille Day by Rush?
I love that.
You was air guitaring in the studio there.
I am such a big Rush fan, so, you know, that just, you've made my day.
I made your day there. Fantastic. That's lovely. So, the next question, I just want to come back to the question, can moderate voters who are considering voting for Le Pen really trust her de-demonisation strategy?
I don't think many moderate voters will vote for her, no. I mean, her de-demonisation strategy.
But people who are sort of on the fence, sort of...
I mean, no, you're right. There are voters on the left who feel that it's very difficult, particularly Mélenchon supporters, who are very compromised about the idea of voting for Macron, even though it means, you know, it's kind of this idea of defending the Republic. Because until, you know, even up until 2017, we talked about this idea of Republican discipline, Republican defence, that there were the far right had to be stopped at all costs. And that's not wearing so well for some of Mélenchon's voters because of 5 years of Macron and this idea of the président des riches.
So with Mélenchon, this is because we were talking during Rush that because it's Marine Le Pen, that's what everyone's drawn to is the talking point.
Yeah.
But actually a huge, obviously we've seen the traditional parties burn to the ashes.
Yeah.
That's been slightly overlooked, but even more overlooked is that Mélenchon nearly beat Le Pen.
Yeah.
And there is a new movement in France.
No, absolutely. There's a new left-wing movement. Well, a new left-wing movement. No, La France Insoumise has been around for a while. It was, you know, the new movement that he created for 2017. But the problem for La France Insoumise is that it's really, you know, based around one charismatic politician. There are other figures behind Mélenchon, but it's very much, I don't know if any of your listeners followed the series Baron Noir, but there's a character in there who is just basically, it's Mélenchon, and the idea is that it's very much this charismatic former Trotskyist left-wing leader, and, you know, people rally to him because they see him as representing the left. But the problem with it is that I suspect a lot of his voters, people who voted for Mélenchon, who, as you say, came very close. You know, there was a point on the night of the 10th of April where he was within a percentage point of her. A lot of his voters are disillusioned with Macron, and they're voting, you know, the tactical vote was very clear, have voted for Mélenchon but might not vote for him in the general election. So the problem is, can he use coming third to create a serious new left-wing party?
Who do you think will chip away at the Mélenchon vote?
I think that most of Mélenchon's electors will vote for Macron in spite of themselves, because there is still this...
hold their nose.
I think they will do it holding their nose, as you say. It'll be the Republican discipline thing, you know. I mean, Mélenchon himself said, not a single vote for her, which of course doesn't mean.
But then at the same time, he said not. He didn't specifically endorse Macron.
No, he didn't endorse Macron. That's absolutely right. But he didn't in 2017. You know, so in a sense, that hasn't changed. But he's letting his voters, you know, choose for them for themselves. Not that he could ever force you can ever force your voters to vote one way or another. But he's not given them a clear steer. Whereas the Socialist Party. So that's three men and a dog. but also the main...
François Hollande somewhere.
François Hollande. And the... but the most importantly, I think, the left-wing newspaper Libération said yesterday, however much you might dislike him, their front page was quite clear. Macron. You know, it's a picture of a voting slip being put into... And in France, your voting slip, you don't put a cross, okay? You have a voting slip with the name of the candidate, and it's clearly seeing Macron being put into the ballot box.
So you couldn't imagine people on the far left who are attracted to her more left-wing economic policies voting for her?
Well, I don't think she has left-wing, you know, economic policies. I mean, her economic policies would be pretty disastrous. And actually, they would, in fact, you know, it's kind of...
What about cutting VAT from 20% to 5.5%?
You know,
and getting rid of income tax for those under 30.
Who pay very little in income tax anyway. I mean, the French income tax system, please don't think that income tax in France is the same as...
I did plenty of research. It's very complex and based on the family.
It's very complex. The whole tax system is based on the family, but income tax is one of only a raft of taxes. Okay, so it's not like you and your young peers here at the University of Nottingham would pay no income tax. Wow, that sounds like a massive incentive.
And even more complicated than PAYE.
Absolutely, it's not at all. It's only part of the whole sort of tax setup. So it would not benefit actually young people to such a great extent.
What about removing subsidies on green energy? Because that's apparently a huge amount of expenditure. Macron even agreed, but instead came up with an alternative. He didn't want to scrap it, but he wanted to put a price cap on energy.
Well, that's what he's done. I mean, the energy, when it became clear that energy prices were going to go through the ceiling in France, he put a 4% cap on tariff increases. You know, that's what the government can do in France. The state says to the companies, you're going to have to suck it up. You are going to have to absorb the increase in costs, not the consumer. Or the consumer's contribution will be a rise of 4%. Well, I don't know about your electricity bills, but mine's doubled over the last year.
It all gets passed down to us.
So, what he is saying is you do... So Le Pen's response to that is, we just scrap VAT or we reduce VAT. But again, that's not actually... It looks democratic on the surface, but the impact on the individual is not the same because... You know, people like me actually can afford 20% VAT, whereas poor people on lower incomes, people with big families who need electricity, you know, they can't afford it, but I'm getting a break. So it's not working out. No. It's not actually as democratic as it looks.
What about removing the subsidies for green energy? What about that element of her policy? Would that benefit?
Well, that's absolutely fundamental. She's a climate skeptic.
Yeah.
You know, she's... In that sense, she's absolutely typical of the international far right, not just the European far right. You know, it's climate change denial is fundamentally part of her makeup. Or actually, I don't care. Go and drive your diesels as much as you like, or your gas guzzlers. Actually, when you begin to dig underneath it, the people who do well out of Le Pen will not be the ordinary French people.
Interesting. In 2018, Macron was accused by many left-wing critics for having an inherent dislike of poor people after declaring France spends far too much dough on social security.
Yeah.
A policy he has set out at this election is that all social benefits for unemployment, housing or childcare will be centralised into a single system, affecting up to 20 million people. To me, that looks sort of like universal credit.
Yeah.
How is this going to potentially affect working class people, and what sort of reaction is this policy having in France?
Well, again, the theory is, you know, you and I, you use the word universal credit, and of course that's exactly what it looks like. Yeah. And I think the problem with it is the rollout. It's not so much the
which was disastrous in this country.
Yeah, well, the principle is, I mean, I've been following some comments on, you know, various accounts and various accounts of the rollout of this and how it's all being applied. In actual fact, what he's doing is taking something that exists and slightly tinkering with it and making it look slightly stronger. But the problem is always going to be the software you're using to analyze, the people who are doing the analysis of who's eligible for it, how much they're eligible for, and that's where the problems arise. So yeah, it looks great. It's kind of what he's trying to do is make it look like a policy that Benoît Hamon brought to the table in 2017, the socialist candidate, which is the idea of a universal income, you know, that everybody gets 750 euros a month, irrespective of their status, whether they're in work, whether they're in such and such, and we start, that's where everybody starts, and that kind of was kicked into touch even by Mélenchon. But it's kind of looking at that, trying to look like there's a social a social program, a welfare program, because the French are very attached to that idea of their welfare program.
So is this him reaching out to working class voters?
I think so, and certainly his talk about his softening of his position on pensions reform as well is about trying to reach out to Mélenchon voters. But you know, kind of the part of the discourse of the Mélenchon vote of the Mélenchon camp has been expecting Macron to suddenly become a Mélenchoniste. Well, that's not going to happen.
It's not going to happen.
Because there are a lot of people in France who don't think that that's a good idea as well. So, and they get their chance to vote on that tomorrow.
So at the debate, President Macron said during the debate, Marine Le Pen would start a civil war if she banned the hijab. Would the election of Marine Le Pen lead to an even more increasingly divided society in France?
Well, you know, you and I are old enough to remember what happened after the Brexit vote. You know, those demonstrations with placards, you've got two days to get out. You know, that kind of interpretation of what the vote meant. And I think that we would see quite a lot of... I think there is potential for a great deal of violence.
Wow.
There. And I think that, you know, the kind of the génération identitaire people would certainly be out in force... perhaps, you know, from Monday, maybe they'd wait until Eid. You know, I think the security services must be having kittens at the moment, thinking about the potential for violence. And I think that that's a very great danger. Now, Le Pen has softened her position, or tried to, or basically just contradicted herself when it comes to, you know, the idea of the wearing the foulard, the hijab, whatever it is, this kind of outward sign of religious belief in public space. But the big problem is going to be how people out in France interpret that. And, you know, people taking it into groups of far-right activists taking the law into their own hands. That's going to be a very difficult thing to manage.
It does seem to the dislike or mistrust of Islam in France does seem to have a veracity and an incendiariness that it doesn't really have in Britain, which is not to discredit what it's like in Britain, but it does seem to be a lot more fervent and the contempt is stronger. So is the possibility of that being released quite dangerous?
More
dangerous than it could be in Britain, I should say.
That's a great question.
I think so. I mean, I think that part of the problem, what we haven't talked about today, and there probably isn't time, but it's the idea of, you know, the degree to which other parties have mainstreamed some of the policies of, you know, you're both politics students, so the idea of, you know, how the way that mainstream parties have themselves mainstreamed radical ideas. So the left, for example, in the name of, under François Hollande, in the name of the secular state, pursues a policy of banning in schools the wearing of the headscarf, whereas we just don't worry about that here.
Yeah, it's not.
We've got time for one last quick question, and then it's 11 o'clock.
All right, yeah, are you happy to stay around for a little bit longer?
I can stay around a little bit longer. Perfect, it really depends on fantastic. How much airtime you've got.
We're joined by Dr. Paul Smith, Associate Professor of French History and Francophone Studies at the University of Nottingham, a regular contributor to France 24 and author of the Fifth and a Half Republic blog. This is University Radio Nottingham.
And this is the UK number one from 1967, Je t'aime moi non plus.
It's one of those songs that you know, but you don't know the name of it. Everyone knows it, but they don't know the name of it.
Moi non plus.
Yes, it's 11 minutes past 3. 3 minutes past 11. This is University Radio Nottingham with George Scotland and Damian Stephen. And we're joined by regular contributor to France 24, Paul Smith.
And they obviously don't pay the professors well because we just slipped him a fiver and he's agreed to stay on for a little bit longer to answer some more questions.
Fantastic, yeah.
Are you taking part in the campus protests?
It's a bit of a personal.
He doesn't have to answer that one.
He doesn't, definitely does not have to answer that. He's also on, just want to plug what you're doing at 1 o'clock so we look even better, Paul.
Well, I'm doing I'm doing talk radio with Trisha.
Trisha Goddard, obviously formerly early 2000s.
Yep, absolutely. TV yeah, well, she has a show, a lunchtime show on talk radio, and I was on it last Saturday. We had she's very interesting, isn't she, Trisha?
Yeah, she's great.
And we had a very interesting discussion, her and another guest and myself. And she's invited me back because it went so well. So there you are.
Are you hoping to be going on Julia Hartley Brewer or Mike Graham's show in the future?
I'll tell you what, though. I was once invited on GB News, but I was washing my hair. Now, as you two gentlemen and any of my students are listening will know, me washing my hair would not take very long.
Do you think, sorry Paul, do you think the future, considering what we've talked about, Mélenchon and Le Pen and the likes of Zemmour coming to the mainstream and taking away the votes from the traditional centre right and centre left, do you think the French politics will continue down the route of normalisation for parties previously considered to be extremely impalatable on either side of the political spectrum?
I think that we're facing France is facing a really significant point in its political development. I mentioned earlier this idea of the presence of three forces. It's not an original thought. Thomas Piketty, the left wing economist, talked about this back in 2017. Eurosceptic, far left with a radical program, progressive pro European centre bloc. Far right nationalists, and no space in that for the old mainstream parties. And I think that it'll be very interesting to watch what we've kind of touched upon. There's a general election that follows in June, and it'll be very interesting to see how that pans out in terms of the parties. I mean, one of the things that Mélenchon has been saying is, you know, vote for, he's not said, at no point, as you precisely said previously, at no point has he said vote Macron, he said don't vote Le Pen, because I think he and a lot of the others are really counting on the post 24th of April, because from tomorrow, once we know the result, then we can throw ourselves as political parties into the campaign for seats in the National Assembly, the equivalent of the House of Commons. 577 seats right across France and in France's overseas territories, and for French nationals living abroad, who massively vote Macron, by the way. I'm going to be taking my wife to vote tomorrow over in Birmingham.
Oh, she's French.
Yeah, and French nationals have the right to vote. They elect deputies, they elect senators, they vote in the presidential election. And
she a Le Pen supporter?
And not at all. You know, Le Pen got 3% of the vote with French nationals living abroad. They voted massively Macron and Mélenchon. So there's that kind of, you know, trendy lefties and centrists, but not generally not on the right. But
it would be like British nationals in Gibraltar voting for UKIP.
Absolutely.
I don't think they have any candidates out there, or ever had.
Quite so. But to come back to your original question, I think that France is in a very interesting place. From my perspective, as somebody who writes on French politics and history, France is in a very interesting place politically, but it is also in a very challenging place in terms of what happens next. Can we imagine a situation whereby Macron doesn't get a majority, or if Le Pen, you know, one of the other things that's being argued is that Le Pen might get elected tomorrow but would not have a majority. What happens then? Yeah, I mean, the institutional crisis that would provoke. I mean, I know I've got a pretty good idea what she would try to do, which is to govern without a majority in Parliament. There are...
That's fundamentally undemocratic, though.
Well, you know, but she's not a Democrat. I know she talks about democracy and referenda as being the most democratic form there is, but you and I...
tool of the totalitarian, as it's often been alleged.
Absolutely, but there was a reason why when de Gaulle returned to power and said, and put the referendum not in one place but two places in the constitution, the kind of the republic, the traditional republicans, kind of said that this was a horrific thing. This is a tool of authoritarianism, because of course it bypasses parliament. The point is that
is this the article of the constitution that both Macron and Le Pen have both been asked about, where they can put through legislation without a parliamentary vote?
Yeah, Article 11. There are two ways. One of them, Article 89, allows you to change the constitution, but you have to get a vote through both houses of parliament in identical form, and then you can go to a referendum. That's what they did with the European constitution in 2005, which, as we know, failed.
Long wind at this.
Or you can, under that, you can actually...
Still enacted, by the way, that constitution.
You can get, the Lisbon Treaty, basically. But Article 11 allows the President of the Republic to put a question directly to the people without Parliament's approval. Okay, so the President is, in this situation, she is supposed to ask the opinions of the Prime Minister and the speakers of the two houses. But apart from that, and they're much more political, by the way, than the speakers in our system. But she could just ask any question. Now, of course, as we all know, a referendum, it depends what question you ask. But do you also assume the consequences? I mean, she talks about this idea of a referendum over immigration. What if she loses? What would she do? Would she resign? Would she then spark a new presidential election? What would happen in that situation? So if she's going to use these levers to bypass Parliament, if she doesn't get a majority, I mean,
credibility is finished if that sort of situation was to take.
Well, essentially provoking a situation of constitutional chaos. So would she be prepared if she doesn't get a majority? If she wins tomorrow and doesn't get a parliamentary majority, how far is she prepared to go in terms of seeking a consensus in any kind of compromise with whoever does? And that's what Mélenchon was talking about last week when he said to the French, vote me Prime Minister. You don't vote for the Prime Minister, but what he was basically saying is, give me a majority, vote for my candidates. And she was saying the same thing in reverse, as it were. I think it was either yesterday or on Thursday, where she said that she anticipated that if she's elected, of course she would say, when I'm elected on Sunday, that I expect the French will then go out and massive and give me a majority. And of course that's what they've done in the past. Yeah. Since we've had the system whereby you have a president elected and then have a general election. So since 2002, the French have always gone out in smaller numbers. You have a quite a high abstention rate, or relatively, but they go out and they give the president who is elected a majority in the National Assembly. Because the constitution says that the setup is that you have a system whereby the government must have the confidence of parliament, really meaning the National Assembly, and the National Assembly has a means of getting rid of a government that it doesn't like. But actually that is biased towards the government. The system that de Gaulle put in place was all about trying to give government the tools with which to govern, because up until then, those of you who know your history of the Third and Fourth Republic in France, the government changed roughly once every 6 months.
Yeah.
No, it's like the Italian system. You know,
I was about to say, the only the Italians really compare.
Absolutely.
Le Pen wants to reintroduce the seven-year presidency. What would this mean?
Well, the idea of the seven-year presidency is precisely that, to uncouple a president from a majority. The reason it was done away with was because France went through these periods in the 80s and 90s of what they called cohabitation, that you'd have a president of one colour versus a National Assembly of another. And nobody in the political setup at that time really wanted that to continue. And there was a happy accident whereby in 2002 they were due to have the next presidential election, 1995 to 2002, and because there was a dissolution in 1997, add 5 years, 2002. So actually in 2000, Jacques Chirac suggested to the French people, shall we just cut the presidency to 5 years as part of modernization? 7 years is a long time.
It is, isn't it? Yeah.
So what she is suggesting is that actually you should go back to the old system, and you would have a president who's elected, and then obviously, you know, initially we would have to have a National Assembly elected, and then let's say that she stages a referendum which gives her a 7-year term of office, so from now through until 2029, but the National Assembly would be re-elected in 2027, and that would kind of become, always assuming that she gets a majority and it lasts that long, that would become a kind of, you know, a general election held not necessarily, you know, held on her record.
Interestingly, so what, in your personal opinion, what are the advantages and disadvantages of reintroducing the seven-year presidency?
Well, a lot of people have said precisely that there was a that it should. A lot of commentators have said it should never have really been allowed to happen. That by you, what you've done is you've a system that was very heavily biased towards the president and the government in the first place, the Fifth Republic, you know, has kind of tied the two together, a majority in parliament. And so the sense is that, you know, the president, it kind of has kicked into touch the idea of the National Assembly, election to the National Assembly, as being precisely that, as being an alternative way of expressing your democratic view, that there does need to be some kind of consensus, there does need to be a compromise between, you know, at times between the head of state, that cohabitation actually was not such a bad thing after all. Others say that it was actually the logic, the initial logic of de Gaulle, and certainly if you go back historically, Pompidou in 1973 wanted to shorten, he's the guy who follows de Gaulle as president of the Republic. Pompidou wanted to shorten it to a five-year term, make it more sort of logical that the two are tied together. But that was rejected by his own party because there was a very strong kind of Gaullist orthodoxy still, that because de Gaulle had had this system of 7 and 5, thou shalt not fiddle with the constitution of de Gaulle. Then later on it gets changed. I mean, there are advantages to both.
And what would you say is better?
I prefer the old system personally, but I'm, you know, I'm a left wing voter who's fundamentally conservative with a small C.
See, fair enough. Should we play our next song?
Yes, this is Kraftwerk and Tour de France.
Tour de France. We play the music.
George Scotland and Damian Stephen, The Breakfast Show. URN.
We play this.
DJ.
Is URN
University
Radio
Nottingham.
Right, sorry. We're back on air with Professor Paul Smith.
Yeah, it's coming up to 20 past 11. We're joined by Paul Smith, regular contributor to France 24, also on Talk Radio 1 p.m. Professor of Francophone Studies and also author of the Fifth Republic blog. Hello again, Paul.
Hello,
Paul. Why, from my observations, why is there a favouring of Marine Le Pen by the British political right? What's going on there?
Well, I think they think that if she wins, then she will bring the EU to its knees. And they're...
I kind of do sympathise with that.
You know, the idea is that... look, you know, Brexit was driven by disaster capitalism. And that's my analysis of it anyway. We can argue the toss over that later, but it's driven by disaster capitalists. And so, you know, people who win whichever way. And they would really see... And this is actually what that's one of the aspects that she's... That they would love that. But we need to be really careful here, because one of the things that was very clear in the run-up to this election is that it's not very easy for far-right-wing parties in Europe to agree, because nationalists don't agree with each other, because actually the bottom line is the French nationalists hate the Brits, British nationalists hate the French, German nationalists hate the French and the British, Hungarian nationalists hate everybody, Polish nationalists hate Putin. There is no, you know, one of the big arguments between Le Pen and the leaders of the PIS party in Poland is precisely over their attitude toward Poland, of Ukraine, and the attitude towards Putin. And nationalists fundamentally in the end will never agree, because they will always have their national, whatever that means, interests at heart. So every time in the last 2 years that there's been an attempt to create a kind of union of European nationalist parties, it has collapsed, because actually we're not capable of of they are not capable of talking intelligently to one another.
And it's an inherent problem with that ideology.
Of course it is. Unless you've got something in common, which usually means beating up a common enemy, or picking on a common enemy, unless you've got something that binds you together, what on earth is going to keep French nationalists and German nationalists together? Answers on a postcard, please. The immigrant question, the immigration question, the movement of populations question, don't expect from a British perspective a government led by, a state led by Marine Le Pen to be accommodating in any way, shape or form. Because she will not do that. Will not be her approach. She's been highly critical.
That's what I've been saying. The migrant. I know we're into hypothetical slightly. If she becomes president, but the migrant crisis would not alleviate itself if she became president, would it?
She would be down Decathlon buying inflatable boats and sending them across the Channel before you could say Jacques Robinson.
With a middle finger or two fingers, with a goulard in between.
No. It wouldn't be well. Or the old French, you know. What they call the arm of the bras d'honneur, the arm in your elbow and doing that.
Yeah, yes, that's the look.
That was, you know, there is no, she would completely dismantle the I'm trying to think of the name of the agreement. Is it the Le Touquet agreement or was it, it's one of those.
Yeah, yes.
One of that, you know more than I do because you're politics students. So, you know, that agreement would just go out the window. So any kind of understanding between Britain and France it's just an illusion. It's just an illusion that Johnson and Le Pen, they might do the handshaking, the smiling for the cameras, but she has no idea of what the British are about. She has no understanding of the other. Don't expect it to become a
category. Is it not inherently Hegelian and mutually beneficial for Britain and France to have an ambivalent and antagonistic relationship? Do we not need each other for that reason?
We need them more than they need us for that. The French are not as obsessed. You know, they like beating us at rugby.
Yes.
They like mocking our non-existent cuisine. Yes. You know, that's but we are not the go-to. It's a bit like, you know...
Well, the Germans,
of
course.
It's a bit like in football, isn't it? You know, we all think that the Germans hate us when we play them at football. The Germans don't care. German football team is much more interested in beating the Dutch.
Yes.
You know, that's the great rival.
And they care more about which World Cup was it in the 80s? They care more about losing that than they do about losing 1966.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's not, you know, we have this, you know, the British live in this kind of, you know... special place that we've created, and we're all part of that. But the French are not sitting there thinking, "Oh, we must vote for Le Pen because this will make the British happy." You know, they honestly don't care.
We've got a Leonard Cohen song coming up later that's about the German war in 1940, and it's written as a Frenchman going to war, and yeah. and obviously there's a dislike and a bit of a rivalry.
But you know, one of the things I admire about the French is that they've put that to bed.
Yeah. Well, now
they have now put that, you know, post the understand they un, they've understood after three wars, 1870, 1871, 1914, 1918, the period 1939 to 1945, that something had to change. And de Gaulle knew that, and you know, the French political leaders and most French people, you know, they might come out with, they're not big fans of the Germans. You know, German tourists turn up in their cars and they don't love that necessarily, but they're not antagonistic towards the Germans in the way that the British are antagonistic to everybody.
So Paul, 44% of 18 to 24 year olds voted for Le Pen in 2017, and this time around she has pledged to remove income tax for young people under 30. Why do you think it is both much more acceptable and much more likely for the French youth to endorse what is a far-right candidate compared to the attitudes and social unacceptability of it all as a candidate in Britain?
Well, I don't know what's the analysis. What were the figures amongst young voters for voting for the Conservative Party in 2019?
I'm not sure.
I mean, it's absolutely, absolutely true that there is a big youth vote, a kind of identitarian youth vote. Insofar as young people are mobilised in France, this time round, they seem to be more mobilised for her or more mobilised for Mélenchon than they are for Macron. And I can understand that. You know, Macron's politics is not exactly exciting.
Are they just completely disenfranchised with the centrism?
Well, I think they're also aware that there is a bit of a crisis going on in French education. And I don't think that the government has handled things like the university admissions have been mismanaged by a succession of governments. Schools have become kind of political playgrounds, you know, for dealing with all kinds of social and political issues. There is a crisis in the education system that Macron has not addressed. And that's what young French people are confronting every day.
So the problem is that education in France is very politicized from a teaching perspective. There's politicized teachers.
Yeah, it's not so much that it's politicized, but it's that lots of social problems are dumped on the education system. You have an endless, it's not unlike in this country, to be honest, you have an endless program of reform. You know, we're endlessly changing the curriculum. Macron says if he's re-elected tomorrow, maths will be put back as a core subject on the baccalaureate.
We were laughing at that. We thought that was incredible that maths wasn't taught as a core subject.
Well, no, we're talking about A-level.
I didn't do maths A-level. Okay, yeah.
The idea is that you'd have to carry on with maths post A-level. I mean, we all did maths up to GCSE. Yeah, okay. Well, I did it O-level. Which, of course, back in the day was the equivalent of having a degree. But
our education standards have slipped somewhat. So
we'll not go down that path today. Don't get me started. I love my students in an appropriate manner. But I think that young people in France are not... Macron's policies are very technocratic. This is one of the criticisms of him. They are very detailed. But that is not the kind of thing that is kind of rallying the masses.
Whereas
Mélenchon talks the talk, Le Pen talks the talk, whether either of them is actually capable of walking the walk, we may never know. But that is very attractive to young people. And there's also been, and I've seen it, you know, it's not just in France, a kind of polarization of opinions amongst young people. Whereas once upon a time, we always thought that people when they were younger tended to be more progressive, more left wing. And as they got older, they would become more and more reactionary. We don't see that so much now.
It's the over 65s that are voting for Macron, isn't it?
Because the over 65s have already got their pensioners.
They don't have to find work.
I'm all right, Jack. I'm fine. I've got my pension. So they would vote for him.
But is that not a more advanced situation than we currently have in the Anglosphere? Because in the Anglosphere, this idea of a large body of young voters going to the far right candidate would never happen. But is that something that you think is on the horizon, perhaps?
Well, again, I'd be very interested to know if we have that sort of breakdown of how what proportion of young people. Let's put the Brexit referendum to one side, because you know there was very much that kind of discourse of youth voted to stay in, old people voted to come out. What are the actual statistics of people voting for Boris in 2019? You know, that's what I'd be much more interested in. What are the statistics? How many young people voted for Trump?
But would you not say that Boris is a false equivalence because he's much more of a centrist compared to someone like Trump or Nigel Farage?
Well, I mean, I don't see his party as being on the centre.
I consider him New Labour, so we've got different ways of looking at it.
He might be, we can have this discussion in another time, another place. He actually kind of is sitting on a party that is far more right-wing than he is.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Definitely.
As a front bet, Jacob Rees-Morgan, pretty much much more to the right than
absolutely.
He is.
Absolutely.
I don't know what he stands for personally.
Well, I mean,
easy to slip into a discussion about Boris Johnson.
The hard Brexiteers as well feel that he's let them down. But that's another story for another time. Yep. But I do think we are seeing a big change. I think I don't think it's just in the Anglosphere. I think, you know, we could, not in the Anglosphere. I think if we were able to really drill down into the views of young people nowadays across the board, we would find that they've shifted from that kind of progressive view towards towards something else.
Either side of the...
Their interests, the things that motivate them are way different.
I can see why, because
we squeeze in one more question and then the time is half past.
Well, I've got two more. Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so going on to representative democracy and seeing young people being disenfranchised, disengaged, etc. What does the low turnout recent elections in French politics say about the current state of and for the future of representative democracy in France?
Well, I think it says the same as it says in most countries. You know, let's put this into perspective. 73% of the voters did turn out to vote. That's still a lot. You know, when we think about the figures that we get here, but it is the lowest apart from 2002. It is the lowest that we've seen since the inception of the Fifth Republic, since 1965, when we had the president elected by universal suffrage. And I think there is a certainly a level of disengagement, or feeling that politics might happen in other places. You know, politics doesn't just have to be in Parliament, doesn't just have to be the presidency. It could be happening in other ways. You know, I may feel politically engaged, and that political engagement might actually mean that I'm running English classes for refugees, that I'm participating in a food bank. So politics might be happening in different places. My sense of disengagement, all right. So my sense of disengagement is expressed in a failure to vote, an abstention, if you like. But actually, I'm politically motivated in different ways.
Perfect. So I'm just going to ask you. This is going to be the final question. So. Two clear and contrasting visions for France. What would either look like by the turn of the next election in 2027?
Sorry, could you ask the question?
Yes, yeah. Two contrasting visions for France. What would either look like by the turn of the next election in 2027? So what would a Macron presidency look? What would France look like in 5 years' time under Macron? And what would France look like under 5 years' time under Marine Le Pen?
Okay, well, I think that if it were Marine Le Pen, that we would have a much more fragmented society than even we have at the moment. I know that she talks about herself as the national unity candidate, but that national unity is racialized, it is essentialist, and I'm very, very wary of what that might be. Macron, I would just think, like many French people, that they would like to go back to something like the social kind of model that they had before, but they've got to reform their pension system because they simply can't afford to run it.
It's a big issue.
Doesn't seem unreasonable, does it, asking people to work till they're 65? I'm going to have to work till I'm 67, so I've got no sympathy with it.
So this is University Radio Nottingham. You are, and you've been listening to George Scotland and Damien Stephen and Associate Professor Paul Smith. And regular France 24 contributor is going to be going on Talk Radio later with Trisha Goddard.
An hour and a half.
We've talked revolution, we've talked reform, and now we're going to sing a bit about regicide. This is Kill the King by Rainbow.
Thank you very much, Paul.